This is Cody from Wage War, and you're listening to As the Story Grows.
Welcome to the next chapter of As the Story Grows. I'm Brad Patton. This week, Wage War guitarist and clean vocalist Cody Quistad joins the podcast. Wage War just released Manic on Fearless Records. Cody and I chatted while the band was out on the final week of their tour with Beartooth. Cody talks about the evolution and origin of the band's name, wanting to write about the last year and a half without writing a COVID record, and pushing the band's sound musically. I'm a huge fan of Manic, and I highly recommend giving it a spin, and I hope you enjoyed this week's chat with Cody from Wage War.
Going good, man. In Worcester, Massachusetts. I think it's the correct way to say it.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, you guys are out with Beartooth.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. Is this the first day of the tour or?
No, we have about a week left.
Awesome. How's it been being back out on the road?
It's been great, man. A lot of fun. You know, a lot of definitely an interesting time. As it would be just kind of coming back from all this, but it's been really good. And, been having a blast.
That's awesome. Was there any like trepidation for you guys to like get back out there on the road, or were you just like itching to do it?
I think it was probably a healthy mix of both. Obviously it's kind of unknown territory right now. And so kind of being some of the first trailblazers was interesting for sure, but we were also just really excited to get back out and get the show back on the road. So yeah, it's cool.
That's awesome. You're originally from Florida?
Correct.
What was growing up like?
Growing up in Florida was great. We're all from Central Florida. I'm specifically grew up in a really small town called Fruitland Park. Grew up a mile from pretty much any one of my family members, grandparents, aunts, uncles. And eventually made the move to Ocala, which is just about an hour north. And that's kind of where the band started. And that's where Dater members from. Under Oath came up around there as well. So, it was cool.
What brought you that way? School?
No, my parents work.
Oh, they moved when you were younger.
Yeah.
Awesome. What got you into music?
Both my parents are musicians. My dad is a bass player. He's a fun house guy. He can play guitar. He's kind of a jack of all trades. And my mom is a music major. And so she's an incredible singer as well. So just kind of them and just kind of naturally fell into it, I guess.
That's awesome. What drew you to guitar?
I don't know. I think it was just kind of like, I guess growing up, I thought it was like the cool instrument. So I was like, this is like rock star. You know what I mean? I got my first guitar when I was like 11. So, I don't know. I think it was just kind of the thing that I gravitated towards for whatever reason.
That's awesome. What was your gateway into heavier music?
I think it was Under Oath, They're Only Chasing Safety. I think is kind of where it started for me. And then, oh no, actually, there's this band called Mortal Treason. They're on Solid State Records. I think they have like two records out.
Yeah.
But they were like very, very extreme. And I think, you know, all around the time that I started getting into heavy music, like, it was just, it started being like a funny thing to me. It's like, man, I can't believe that, like, people do this. And then, like, the deeper I got into it, the more I started to enjoy it. As Lay Dying was a really big band for me. Pretty much the reason that I'm in a metal band. I got Shadows of Security, I think it came out in like 2005. And I literally just wore that record out. So that's kind of where I cut my teeth in heavy music and guitar playing and such.
That's awesome. What time did you start playing in bands? In high school or?
No, I think in middle school, like my first like proper show with like a band was seventh grade, I believe.
They say that there's no love. Don't think to watch your tone. No.
I was in another band with Seth, who currently in the band playing guitar. And we just kind of had a, you know, let's see the right way to say this. We were just all, I think we were all on different planes as far as where we wanted to take that band. So, you know, we started a version of Wage War, Found Britain. And we had a different bass player and drummer at the time. That was like 2010, started playing local shows. And then we had to go through a couple of name changes because there's just literally no good band names left. And then 2013 was solidified this lineup and this band name. So we can, the rest is history, as they say.
Awesome. What led to the name change from Empires to Wage War?
It went from Empires to War Within and then War Within to Wage War. There was a very prominent like indie rock band out of Chicago called Empires. And yeah, we just kind of, we weren't in a position to, you know, take on a band like that. And then we became War Within and we had these like scrims made with two W's. And we got like a cease and desist from like some bar band or something in Nashville that literally just like plays, you know, like random cover games or whatever. So, yeah, again, like we didn't really have the jurisdiction to take them on. So we were kind of stuck with these two WW scrims. And we was like, well, it'd be really cool since we just spent $500 on these to find a band name that we can be reusable and everything. I was saying it was my mom that said Wage War, and we were like, yeah, that's pretty cool, and so it just kind of stuck, and honestly, I think it's a great band, man. I can't believe that we landed on something that we actually all like, so.
Yeah, it's a good name. That's funny that it's your mom that came up with it. That's
yeah.
How'd you guys get connected with Fearless Records?
We had a friend named Sal who used to work at Fearless, and at the time Josh Woodard from I Didn't Remember was co-managing our band, and he had sent it to Sal, and his song was Basic Hate off of our first record, and yeah, it was just kind of the rest is history from there. And that was 2014, I believe.
That's awesome. I'm curious how COVID and the lockdowns affected the band and the writing and process for this new record.
Yeah. it's no secret that it really put a hit on everything that, you know, a lot of people in the arts and music have worked on for so long. You know, like, we've been through, you know, world wars and, you know, multiple other sicknesses, but you never really think that, you know, something's going to shut down the entire entertainment industry. So definitely a wake-up call, and kind of makes you not take anything for granted. But it did allow us the time to, you know, work on the record and get it to a spot where we felt like it was great. And yeah, just a lot of time to focus in on that. And, you know, obviously, you know, get to see families. And three of my guys got married during the pandemic. So
oh, wow.
They got to spend the first year at home with their wives, which is a win. So, yeah, it was, you know, there's definitely some victories, but definitely a lot of valleys as well. So, you know, interesting for sure.
Yeah. Did you guys feel like, because you had maybe extra time to write, maybe you didn't have extra time to write, maybe you just had more downtime, that freed you up creatively? Or were there things you wanted to try differently on this record than you'd previously done before?
It's probably a mixture of both. I had started writing this record it was definitely before COVID hit. And then obviously, like, I had all this downtime once COVID hit. And so it was just kind of, you know, I would get up every day and try to create something new. And I think this is definitely our most diverse record to date. You know, I think every song is so different from the other, which is cool to me, because, like, if you listen to it front to back, like, you really get a full experience, as opposed to, like, you know, here's 11 of the same song. And, you know, like, if some songs are, depending on what facet of our band people like, and there are quite a few of them, you know, if you like our hand band because we're heavy and have breakdowns, like, certainly a song's for you on there. And if you like our band because we're melodic, or, you know, certainly a song's for you on there. Like, it's just kind of got this, like, flow to it that, you know, if you don't like one song, if you like, you can listen to the next one, you're probably gonna like it. So yeah, a lot of time to be creative, and I definitely wanted to push the envelope for us as a band on that too.
Had a dream where we were side by side. Would you believe in a world where we weren't blind? I saw us free from pain and hate inside. But I woke to see it was all just in my mind.
Yeah, like, this record, listening to Manic, this was my first time listening to Wage War. And so I'm going to, like, preface everything I'm saying by, like, I love the new record. I think it's phenomenal. And I enjoy it a lot. But it struck me as very much a new metal record. And so when I went back this morning to listen to your older records, I was like, oh, man, they're like a metalcore band from the jump. Like,
yeah.
So it was surprising, which was good. Like, it's always fun to, like, listen to a new record, fall in love with that, and then go back and see what a band was like, in my opinion, especially for bands with a big discography.
Yeah. That's interesting that you pulled new metal from there. Like, I think there's definitely always been a new metal, like, influence on our band, but it's interesting that that was kind of the overarching feel.
And I think this is another record where I like it more, like, I've liked the singles, but I think, like, in the cohesiveness of the record, I've enjoyed it more. Like, Circle the Drain, when I heard that single, I was like, yeah, it's cool. But when I listened to it in context of the record, I really like the song a lot more in context.
Awesome. I love that.
Yeah, I mean, when you're writing and putting together a record, do you know that this is going to be on Spotify and people are going to add their favorites to playlist, and so it's just whatever? Or are you consciously still thinking of like, how do we put this record together so there's a flow and each song going into the next makes sense? Or is it just like, people are going to do whatever they want, so who cares?
Yeah, I mean, I think I still, you know, am kind of old school and like to, you know, thematically ordering, arrange an album. But, you know, I mean, it's always changing. And like I said, like the diversity of this record, I feel like there's a lot of opportunity for playlists. And even though that's not what it was written for, I think there's a lot of different, you know, facets of the band on there. Like there's kind of this whole new, you know, dark, you know, there's like electronic elements that still have, you know, really heavy guitars and breakdowns and vocals. And then there's like, you know, songs with acoustic on it. You know, and there's songs that are literally just metal rippers, like solos and, you know, pinch harmonics and all that stuff. So there's just a lot of different ways that the record can be taken. And I think that's what we're most proud of. And hopefully it lends itself to, you know, both of those, where you can listen to the album front to back and have an experience, or you can find the song that you like and on a playlist and be like, wow, I really like this song. I don't so much care for this one, but I love this song. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. The two singles so far, High Horse and Circle the Drain, very contrasting styles. High Horse is big energy, anthemic, hardcore, like Pantera-esque metal song. And Circle the Drain is this really great ballad. What went into choosing those as your singles to showcase the record?
You know, I mean, it's not a secret that heavy bands always leave with like a heavy single for, you know, the first one back. And so, you know, it was, High Horse is definitely one of the heavier songs on the record. And, you know, it feels good and it represents our band in like all of the ways that the things that we love about heavy music, which is, you know, riffs, heaviness, and then also like, you know, the song has a chorus, even though it's a heavy song, it's still like a heavy chorus. So, I think it's like a good, you know, it's a good judgment of like where the record goes in the heavy department. It's a good judgment, or a good sample of like songwriting for our band and heavy songs, kind of way we've always done things. And then Circle the Drain was kind of like, there's quite a few songs on the record that could fill the Circle the Drain slot for second single. And we had a tough time shooting them out, but I think that ended up being the one that felt, you know, the most, I think had the most promise to it, and, you know, felt like a good meeting of the minds and, you know, kind of important to all of my records.
Where'd the title Manic come from?
I wrote the song, I think I wrote it in like January of this year. And it just kind of ended up making the most sense with the way that the record flows. You know, I didn't want to write a COVID record that's like about the pandemic. Like I wanted to write, you know, I say this a lot, but I view records as yearbooks. So I just wanted to write about the past year and a half, 2 years of, you know, of my life. And I think it ended up, you know, kind of surrounding a lot of the emotions and mental health spaces that that were surrounding, you know, last year and COVID and everything. And, you know, I mean, there's songs about, you know, never, you know, not getting to say goodbye to people. And that's like a real thing where I know a lot of people who have loved ones, you know, dying in hospital beds alone. And there's, you know, the mental health aspect of like being, you know, basically trapped inside your house and like not having, you know, those people around you that you're normally around and love to see, or not being able to see family. You know, there's songs about kind of like relapsing and just kind of like making all of this, you know, mental, physical, whatever progress, you know, sobriety, whatever it could be, like making all this progress and kind of last year being a year of backsliding just because of finding ways to cope with life. So it's just kind of like a very like spanning title, or it's just like, a lot of weird things happened last year, and like I said, there were some good things and, you know, some bad things, so it just kind of felt like the appropriate title. We want to pass, we can't retreat.
Thanks for listening to As the Story Grows. Our intro music was written and composed by Jeremy Hunt. The As the Story Grows theme is by Bob Nana. If you like what you hear, subscribe wherever you get your podcast and give us a rating and review. If you'd like to support the show financially, you can join us at patreon.com/asthestorygrows. Be a part of our community and join the ongoing conversation over on Discord. If you enjoy this episode, share it on social media with your friends. Much appreciated, and thanks for listening.
I never felt so young and alive as when I'm diving into a tomb. And now I'm learning as I listen along, and the wheels are turning, and I started a song. One good word and I'm gone. Better.